Yeah, dear students, we discussed in the last week's subspace clustering as one technique to find groups that belong together in high-dimensional spaces. Before that, we looked at global clustering, and today I want to continue this family of cluster-related techniques and topics with a discussion of validation of clustering results, visualization, and also the role of outliers that may be a side effect of cluster analysis, namely those elements that do not belong to a cluster, but it may also be something that is searched for without any clustering. Yeah, so these are the topics for today. What we see here already at the initial images is several clusters with overlaid centroids, that means the centers of each cluster. That is the basis for one measure of cluster validity. Another one is based on a grid, and that is indicated here on this first image, where you see in a grid overlaid to a clustering of points in three clusters. Yeah, so we discuss validation, which means primarily to use interestingness measures, quality measures for clustering results. So these validation techniques are quantitative and with this also objective, yeah, which is a nice property. But as we will see, that you can measure something does not mean that this is always meaningful, valuable, and useful. It may even be completely misleading. And that a cluster quality measure is misleading becomes primarily obvious if you look at a visualization that tells you and conveys the distribution of the points, where it may turn out that the clustering is almost perfect, but because of the particular measure that is used and the properties of the clustering shapes, the quality measure leads to a low value. So an outlier detection that will be part of the second half of this topic. Yeah, as introduction for the validation process. Clearly, with all techniques that we use in visual analytics, we need some ways to validate whether the results are really meaningful and useful and not just an artifact of a particular technique. This holds for outliers, for correlations, for clustering, for association rules, decision trees, whatever these results are. Yeah, we want to discuss it here, especially applied to clustering. And if we go a little bit more in detail, then it is clear that there are two possible failures of clustering. And using terms that are primarily used in medicine, I want to explain this a bit. Namely so-called false negatives and false positives. False positives in medicine means someone is diagnosed to have a disease, but actually she has not the disease. That's a false positive. And a false negative would be, a woman goes to breast cancer screening, for example. She is told everything is fine, you are completely healthy, but this is wrong. The test result was negative, but in fact she is ill. Translated here to clustering, that means a false negative is there is an essential structure in the data, and in fact it may be a pathological structure if it is applied to medical data. An essential structure is there, but it is not detected. And false positives means something is shown with a clear border as if it would be something interesting, but in fact it is not a meaningful cluster. And if we look at a clustering result in a higher dimensional space involving many data sets, it is very likely that the clustering result contains at the same time some false positives and some false negatives. Yeah, it's typically not the case that everything is over-segmented, meaning that we have just too many clusters, or under-segmented, which means that the number of clusters is just too low. Often it is the case that some clusters are too large and should be further split, whereas others are too small. Yeah. So therefore, cluster validity measures can be applied to one cluster, not to necessarily to the whole set of clusters. But of course, there is also the global assessment that takes into account the quality of all clusters that have been computed. Yeah, so that is meant by the last point. Validation measures may consider individual clusters, but also a global score where the individual cluster quality measures are combined, typically weighted somehow. So a few more introductory comments on validation. In a very fortunate situation, you have a gold standard available. Yeah, so imagine there is data collected on credit card misuse, for example, you know how finance experts assess these data, what is really a credit card misuse and what was just a somehow abnormal situation but without any criminal aspect. Yeah, imagine that you have such information available, ideally not only from one expert, but let's say from three experts. And when the three experts agree, this is indeed something that should be considered as one cluster, whereas other parts of the data are summarized in another cluster. Then you can compare your clustering results, your automatic clustering results, with these manually generated results from the experts. Yeah. That would be a very fortunate situation. And in reality, this situation is very rare. That means you are in the situation where you typically do not have any gold standard, which means you have nothing where you can rely on that this is the truth. And in the absence of any gold standard, quality measures, more specifically cluster purity measures, can be used. And we will discuss and see in some examples three of them: the silhouette coefficient, centroid-based measure, and grid-based measures. By the way, I'm not sure whether you are familiar with the name silhouette. Yeah, a silhouette is the border of something. Yeah, the outer border. Why is this called a silhouette? I was not aware of this for a long time, and that is a pity, since in our group we did research on silhouette visualization and silhouette rendering, and I was not aware what a silhouette actually is. Silhouette was the name of a French politician in the 18th century, Etienne de Silhouette. And when he was in a meeting and that was boring, he started to draw silhouettes. So maybe that helps you to remember what a silhouette is. Grid-based measures. We have talked about grid-based methods for subspace clustering, and you remember that the goal here was to understand whether we have a clusterable subspace, and that was determined by the fact how many cells we have where the number of elements, so that was just a counting procedure, is above a certain threshold. And it turned out that this is often not a particularly good method, because it is so heavily dependent on the grid resolution. We will see that as a cluster purity measure, grid-based approaches can contribute to a quality assessment, but again, this dependency on the resolution is essential. Yeah. So since clustering problems are so similar based on the number of clusters, the density, their shape, and so on, the selection of cluster purity measures is also challenging. And what you definitely should not do is to claim that your clustering result is great because one cluster purity measure alone gives a high value. Yeah, so maybe you have a favorite, the silhouette coefficient, for example, and the only thing you do to assess your data and your clustering results is applying this one measure. That has a high chance of being misleading. Yeah, so there were some previous remarks. Let's go a little bit more into detail what a silhouette cluster actually is. Imagine the following situation. We have a data set or an object, as it was called in these publications, that is assigned to a cluster A. Then the distance of this object to all other objects of the same cluster is computed. Yeah. to understand how well it fits in this cluster. Also, the distance of O to all objects of a cluster B is computed. Yeah, this is the cluster B. And B is chosen such that it is the cluster that is nearest to the cluster A. So there is a chance that object O should even be assigned to cluster B and not to A, because B is chosen such that it is close to A. Yeah. So distance OA means that is the average distance of this object to all other objects from the same cluster. And this distance measure relates to the distance to all objects of the most adjacent other cluster. The silhouette coefficient for this one cluster A is now computed as follows. We subtract the distances to the closest other cluster to the distances to the current cluster. And these values should be higher, yeah? Otherwise O would be in the wrong cluster. So typically we have positive values here. The question is how positive they are. But it may also be the case if O is really at the border between the clusters A and B, it may be even on the wrong side, and then the silhouette coefficient may be even negative. Yeah, so the nominator here is the maximum of all distances from O to objects of the same cluster, or the most similar, the closest other cluster. So this value here is clearly larger than this one. So therefore, the value lies between minus one and one. It cannot be beyond one. Yeah, so that's the cluster coefficient for one cluster A. And to come up with an overall assessment of your clustering results, which does not only involve cluster A, but a certain number of clusters, you have to sum over all clusters, this measure, divide by the number of clusters. So one can say it is normalized by the number of clusters. So this gives you again a value that lies between minus one and one. And if it is, for example, 0.8 or something that is clearly above 0.5, that would indicate that your clustering result is quite good. Let's have a look at some example distributions, the clusters that were computed, and the silhouette coefficient that was computed. Yeah. So here are some examples. I just took them from Wikipedia because I think these are quite useful and illustrative examples. Here we have a point set, I think it's about 100 points, randomly distributed. We have a blue cluster and a red cluster. And you see here the distances for each point to the clusters that belong to the large cluster B. Yeah, and that sometimes leads to high values, often to positive values, sometimes even to negative values. Yeah. So here we have bars that indicate that we have for some objects, negative silhouette coefficients. That means that we have blue points that are on average farther away from other blue points than from red points. And if you look at this sketch, that becomes immediately obvious that there are some points. So I would guess this one and this one and this one. They are so close to many red points, but quite far away from many blue points, leading to negative values. If this is averaged over the whole blue cluster, that results in a silhouette coefficient of 0.12, a quite low value. Positive, but quite low. For the red cluster, it's better. Yeah? No point of the red cluster has a negative silhouette coefficient. That means that they are all closer to other red points, to the average of the other red points compared to the blue points, leading to 0.42. This taken together, average over the two, leads to quite low values. So that's not a very good clustering. Yeah, probably a good clustering would be one that just says this is one cluster. Maybe a few outliers do not belong to the cluster, that would improve it. So that is the assessment of this distribution. Here we have another example, again, two-dimensional data, two clusters, colored red and blue. And we see again for each object, each element here, the silhouette coefficient and then the average numbers for the blue and for the red cluster. Again, it is considerably lower for the blue cluster, which is not too surprising because the blue cluster is also larger. So larger clusters tend to have lower numbers, whereas a small cluster could be one where the elements are really close to each other and then leads to really high values. Yeah. So both the red and the blue cluster here have higher values than here, but still not very high values. Yeah, the average of both would be still below 0.5. Here we have an example where it fits quite well. So here one may say the silhouette coefficient validates that it makes sense to compute two clusters for this point set. They have approximately the same size, but by the way, it's 200 points, I was wrong. 200 points are distributed here. Yeah, here the clusters have approximately the same size and not a single point has a negative silhouette coefficient. Everything that's assigned to the red cluster is closer to the average red points, and the same holds for blue. Both clusters have values above 0.5, and therefore the average, of course, is also above 0.5. So here it is really a good situation. And if you look at the distribution of the data and see these results, this together indeed may confirm the result. Yeah, there are situations where the silhouette coefficient is quite good, but a visual assessment of an expert would show there are still problems with this clustering. But here I would say that's indeed okay. Yeah, so that was what I wanted to show with respect to the silhouette coefficient. The second family of techniques I want to briefly discuss are the centroid-based measures. Centroid-based means, of course, that we compute a centroid for all clusters. So, and what is the centroid of all clusters? We compute, for example, the average position of all points belonging to that cluster. That is the most frequently used way to compute a centroid. Then in the next step, we determine for all points of a cluster Ci the distance to the centroid, and we do the same and compare the distances of the points Pi to the centroids of other clusters named Cj. And of course, the distances to the own cluster centroid Ci should be smaller than to any other cluster centroid. Yeah? And if this would be achieved indeed for all points, then a centroid-based measure would give an ideal value, a maximum value. The maximum value in this case is 100. Yeah? So this has a scale from 0 to 100. You can imagine this as a percentage. What is the percentage of points where the own cluster center is closer than any other cluster center? That indicates the quality of the clustering, how often this really holds. So let's look at examples. Yeah? The clustering results are shown as an X here. Yeah? We have a black cluster, a red cluster, and a blue cluster. And I have not the measure here, but I would assume that we really have quite high values. I'm pretty sure that for the black cluster, the equation holds for every point. That means no black point is closer to the centroid of the red or blue cluster than to the centroid of the black cluster. This will not be the case for all red points. So, for example, we have some red points here. It's obvious that they are closer to the blue cluster centroid. And if I look, for example, at this blue point, I would suppose that it is closer to the red centroid compared to the blue one. But for most of them, this will work. Yeah. So here are some more examples, and here we have indeed the values. It's from a paper from Mike Zips and colleagues, and the cluster validity measure and the visual impression fit quite well, at least that's what I think. This is the better clustering. Yeah? Here we have 90% of the points being assigned to the right cluster, being closer to the centroid of its cluster. Here the centroid is not overlaid, that's a bit a problem, but you may imagine that works quite well. Whereas here we have often situations where in a close neighborhood there are green, red, and blue points, meaning that the clusters are not well separated. So a value of below 50 is really low for a centroid based measure. Yeah, that means almost half of the points is, so to say, in the wrong cluster. Yeah. So that's the centroid based measure. It leads to low values in general for narrow and curved clusters, so-called banana-shaped clusters, yeah? Whereas for convex and compact shapes, the values are higher. Sometimes clusters are split, which means I have something here in a certain part of my data set and something here, and these belong together to one cluster. You may ask why this could be a good idea. Well, the data is clustered based on the attributes for which they stand. Maybe the spatial position is part of the clustering, of the similarity measure used for clustering, but other factors are also important. And then this may be a valid result. Yeah? So for example, what we did in our group is to cluster image data with respect to how likely it is that they belong to a tumor, and the tumor may be malignant or benign. So for the individual elements of the data set, we have a number of information, not only a gray value, also texture values and others. And this leads us to summarize indeed parts that are at distinct regions of the image data. Yeah? That would be something that is referred to as a split cluster. Interwoven clustering means we have a small cluster that is surrounded by a larger one, or even the small cluster is embedded by a larger one. That could mean that the small cluster, the embedded one, and the larger cluster have approximately the same centroid. They are quite close to each other. And then, of course, it seems with the centroid-based measure that many points are wrongly assigned. Yeah? A good property of the centroid measure is that it is relatively robust against different sizes, densities, and numbers of clusters. Yeah? It's not that centroid-based measures get almost always better and better if we have more clusters. So here's an example where the centroid-based measure would lead to low values for one cluster, but since this one cluster is large in terms of the number of points or objects that belong to it, that really has a strong influence. Yeah? Here we have a concave-shaped cluster, a banana-shaped cluster, and we have these three compact smaller clusters. Yeah? Here everything is fine, everything is in the right cluster, no problem. But if this is the centroid for the blue cluster, then of course for all blue points, one of the other centroids is closer, yeah? Either red or black or green. So basically this will tell you the points in the blue cluster are all assigned to the wrong cluster. And if you look visually, yeah, and assess the quality more in this subjective manner, based on your visual perception, you would say, well, the blue cluster is also fine. Here's an example with a split cluster from the same publication from Michael Sedlmeier. And we see here for every cluster the measure, which is very high for Turkeys, 97. Yeah, you remember that 100 is the maximum. Also for the black cluster, it's quite good with 81. But for the green cluster, that is the split one, it is really bad. Yeah, it has only 12. But the split cluster just consists of several distinct subclusters, one may call them, and in fact, the experts in this case rated it as correct. Yeah. So that was an example where the centroid-based measure does not work very well. So therefore, again, it's necessary to do both, compute quality measures and look at the results. So, and then finally, we have grid-based measures. Yeah. Grid-based means, of course, that we overlay a grid on the visualization of the data and the clustering results. And what we do now is for each grid to count how many voxels, how many points of which clusters are in this grid cell. Yeah? And sometimes this number is very low, it's just one or even zero, it's empty. Yeah? Sometimes it's higher than one, like here. But what we want to see is, even if the number is higher than one, they should be ideally from one cluster only. That is here the case for most objects, not for all. Here you see a grid cell where we have blue and red clusters. Here we also have blue and red. We never have black and red or black and blue. Yeah. So the interesting point here again is, of course, the grid size, and the user needs some help in choosing this. Yeah. So what Michael Sedlmayr recommends in his paper, where he describes different clustering problems and possible solutions also for the validity measure, he says, with two-dimensional data, I would use the square root. Yeah. So if I have 1,000 points in my two-dimensional data set, that would result in a grid size of 31 times 31. If the data is three-dimensional, he would use the third square root of n, meaning that for 1,000 points, you have a grid size of 10 times 10 times 10. Yeah? And of course, if you would have five or six dimensional data and only 1,000 points, then of course the density gets lower and you have even smaller grid sizes. Yeah? Yeah, so let's look what happens here. That can be also applied, by the way, for three-dimensional data. When you want to visually assess this, then you have to look at a small scatter plot matrix. So SPLOM stands for a scatter plot matrix. Yeah. The visual separation tells you again whether the grid-based measure is useful. Yeah. The grid-based measure is robust against split clusters, so it could produce very high values if split clusters have a good shape and are indeed quite coherent. The grid-based measure does not care for the shapes of the resulting cluster, so it also would work very well for non-convex shape. Yeah? But of course, the grid resolution has an influence, and basically it should be so chosen such that indeed the situation that several points are in one grid cell occurs not too rarely. Because if typically only one point is in a grid cell, then of course this one point can only belong to one cluster. Yeah? So then you cannot have the situation that there are in one grid cell points of different clusters. And therefore, in such a way, a grid-based measure yields an almost perfect result, even if visual assessment would tell you it's not great. Yeah. So here is such an example. You see the class-wise measures, 100, 100, 100, 100. The lowest value is 95. The average is 99. Yeah. That is the coarse grid overlaid to the data. These are just not many points. Yeah. And you see, that is not a good cluster. We have red points here and here and here, but we very rarely have a red point with another in our grid cell because the cells are so coarse. Yeah. So this is an example where a grid-based measure is misleading. We have seen that for each measure, there are examples where they are really misleading. Not only that they are slightly wrong, but completely misleading. Yeah. So what is a good strategy? Therefore, it's a good strategy to compute different quality metrics, different validity measures, and to visually assess them. So these validation measures can also be used as, yeah, so to say, as input for the some clustering-based methods that require a priori knowledge of the number of clusters that you expect. Yeah, we discussed k-means, fuzzy c-means, k-meduids, k-prototypes. Yeah, the validation measures could be computed for different clusterings, with two clusters, three clusters, four clusters, and so on. And at the end, we say we take the number of clusters n, where our validity measure has the highest value. Yeah, that would be, yeah, quite brute force or naive solution. It is not so simple as this, because several of these validation measures have a tendency that the quality measure either grows or decreases monotonically with the number of clusters. Yeah, so then there should be something like a normalization with respect to this. Yeah, if you choose two different values, let's call them N1 and M2, that should be the number of clusters, and the validation measures are similar, then prefer the lower number of clusters. Yeah, often with more clusters, that's a kind of overfitting to the data, the measures tend to be better. Yeah, at the end, in the extreme case, you consider every point an individual cluster. And then, of course, every quality measure would tell you every point is assigned to the right cluster, because every point is its own cluster. There cannot be something wrong. Yeah. So in general, the validity measures improve with more clusters. That needs to be taken into account. So that was validation. And let's now start with visualization. We discussed already visualizations with respect to subspace clustering results. We discussed that the overlap of dimensions and elements is quite important here. For global clustering, we have similar situation, similar problems, and we want to look at some solutions that have been developed and discuss them a bit. So before we look at solutions, it's always good to understand what are the tasks that an analyst has when looking at clusters. Yeah, the analyst would try to interpret the clusters. Does this make sense? Is this somehow meaningful? Can this be translated to a concept? That's also something we discussed in one of the earlier lectures, the transformation of clusters to concepts that could be labeled. Yeah, then in more detail, evaluate the clusters. Is the grouping really correct? And maybe some refinement is needed in the sense that clusters should be merged with each other or split, or just some elements need to be removed from one cluster and assigned to another one. Yeah, so that is the interactive cycle that could be applied to clustering results, removing elements that sounds like manually moving them away. Maybe there are a little bit more, say, semi-automatic measures that help the user not to select individual elements, but also the algorithm may be started again with different parameters. So if we look a little bit more in detail, if we have 2D data and a hard clustering approach, hard means that it is a binary decision whether something belongs to one cluster or another cluster. There it's useful to show the distribution of the data that belongs to the individual clusters along with basic statistical properties, the descriptive statistics like mean values, standard deviation, median value, interquartile range. It should be clear for every point to which cluster it actually belongs. Yeah. When we have fuzzy clustering, then we also want to see the data distribution and the probability of a point belonging to a certain cluster. Yeah, that should be visualized in such a way that the user can employ this visualization for her quality assessment. So, and then there may be some optional additions. We discussed about Centroids, for examples, as representatives for each cluster. That could be a good idea to visualize as well. And also regression lines could be computed between the individual dimensions of the elements, and that could be done locally for the members or points of each cluster. If we have high dimensional data, we cannot immediately visualize them, but need to project them to a lower dimensional space, 2D or 3D typically. With parallel coordinate plots, we can also display, let's say, 10-dimensional data. For the others, some kind of dimension reduction is necessary. Yeah, so here are the visualization techniques that have been used for global clustering results. I will show some very early techniques. Glyphs that have been used, scatter plots, of course, and parallel coordinate plots. And then we are done with this lecture. In the next video lecture, I will explain other visualization techniques like isolines and enhanced dendrograms. The isolines are particularly for the fuzzy clustering. Yeah. So here you see some very early visualizations of clustering results. I find this really amazing that these data analytics pioneers, as I want to call them, already thought about visually assessing results of machine learning techniques like clustering. Yeah? So what you see here is a distance matrix that maps the distance to another point to darkness. Yeah? This is symmetric because the distance from A to B equals the distance from B to A. We have many low and many small values, and they are somehow arbitrarily distributed. Yeah, these are the point sets, and the clustering is applied, which says this is a cluster and this is a cluster. And now we show again a distance matrix, but it is reordered in such a way that here we only have elements of this cluster, whereas here we have elements of this cluster. So the distances between elements of this cluster to other elements of the same cluster is quite small, and small low values are mapped to dark colors, whereas to the other clusters, other cluster members, the distances are high, leading to bright colors. Yeah? And here it's the same. We have almost homogeneous dark colors, meaning that the distances from elements of that cluster to other elements of the same cluster are low, whereas here we have these higher values. Yeah. So to abstract this a little bit and generalize it, a clustering result is considered as plausible if a distance matrix that is reordered according to the cluster memberships makes the clustering clearly visible in the sense that it appears as a homogeneous region when a color is applied. Yeah? So distance is mapped to darkness. Yeah, then let's discuss the visualization of clustering results with glyphs. There are some design guidelines that I have taken from a paper from Cao et al. So they argue that multiple levels of visual exploration should be supported so that I can see features, the dimensions, the individual points, perhaps subclusters, if I have a hierarchical clustering, and the clusters. A consistent encoding is necessary, so therefore it's recommended to normalize the data and map it always to a range of 0 to 1. Glyphs should be designed such that they are perceived as similar if the underlying data, for example, they represent the size of the cluster, if the underlying data are also similar. I would add, glyphs should be only perceived as similar if the underlying data are in fact similar. Otherwise, they should not be perceived as similar. You may argue that perception is something that is quite subjective. Yeah? And indeed, there are subtle differences, individual differences, for example, how we perceive colors and similarity in colors and contrasts. Yeah? So a particular glyph design is maybe not as effective for all of us. But these individual differences are rather small. There are general tendencies, strong general tendencies for perception, visual perception, that can be used here. And the final point that's important for visual analytics in all areas, interaction is essential. It's not sufficient to come up with one glyph-based visualization of clustering results, but the user should be able to explore it and refine the clusters. Yeah. So colors, of course, are quite useful. As long as people have no strong color vision deficiency, if you use colors with strongly distinct use, German Farbton, that is really perceived as different and not confused with something being similar. Yeah, here you see some 3D visualizations that require rotation, for example, or zooming in order to better understand the distribution of the data. So I want to let it with this, with the glyph-based design. If you look at the slides, there are some slides that I have hidden that show more complex glyphs that have also been used. I decided not to show this in the video lecture and would also not ask you this in an exam, because these glyph shapes are a little bit complex, and I would argue that the learning effort for an analyst is quite considerable. Yeah. So in many cases, colors could be seen as a good choice. Yeah, let's discuss scatterplot a bit more. Typically we have more than two-dimensional data, so there is a kind of dimension reduction involved in a projection process. So that is typically the basis for a scatterplot-based visualization. If we have temporal clustering, that means clustering that reflects time-dependent data and how the clusters form and split and merge and grow over time, we could also think of animated scatterplots, yeah, that show with distinct colors, for example, how these clusters develop over time. That is possible, yeah. And motion perception is something where humans are very good in. But on the other hand, there is also a high cognitive load involved if I see distributions of color that change over time. So this animation should be not too fast, and it should also not take too long. Yeah? Otherwise, there is a high chance that users miss important information. I would argue it's a good idea to combine an animated scatterplot, so really a continuous movement over time, with some static visualizations. Yeah, so here we see an example of parallel coordinate plots for clustering results. And we see, in fact, a special variant of these parallel coordinates, namely it involves edge bundling. Edge bundling means that you find lines that have a similar direction and summarize them, squeeze them and compress them even more to make them better recognizable. Yeah? So this leads to curved lines, yeah, whereas with the original parallel coordinate plots we would have just straight lines. These ones here are curved. Yeah? So with parallel coordinate plots, we can show five-dimensional data, as in this example, without any projection. Yeah, there is all information visible. If you think about how this visualization is generated, you see that the developers must have made some decisions. For example, the magenta lines here are always visible and they are uninterrupted, whereas the blue lines are interrupted when there are magenta lines. The green lines are interrupted when there are blue lines, yeah? Whereas the blue lines are not interrupted by green lines. So there must be something built in, like a drawing order. Yeah? We first show all green lines as the first cluster. On top, we show all blue lines. And on top of this, we show all the magenta lines, meaning that the magenta lines are shown as if they are in front of the blue lines and in front of the green line. It is like a three-dimensional drawing where you start drawing in the back and then come closer. Yeah, some more thoughts on using parallel coordinates for showing clustering results. We have seen in the last example edge bundling, and we have also seen proximity colors, namely that color is used to show cluster membership. Yeah, we could also think about opacity adjustment, which means that we show parallel coordinate lines opaque in the center of a particular cluster, and the more our lines deviate from the center, the more they get transparent. Yeah, all these enhancements have the same goal: to better reveal the clustering structure and to avoid visual clutter. Visual clutter meaning that there is too many information displayed very close to each other. Things get occluded and somehow not clearly visible. Yeah. So here is one four-dimensional cluster shown, and opacity mapping is applied, this technique mentioned here. So this just shows the use of the color to indicate color membership, so-called proximity-based coloring. So there is not just one color for one cluster, but the cluster color is slightly adapted the closer you are to the center of this. Yeah. So here, an exploration at different levels is supported with this set of visualizations. Here we see one cluster, we see the opaque line which represents the center of that cluster, and the more transparent regions that are further away, that is for one cluster. Here we see more clusters, yeah, in a hierarchy we have at a lower level more clusters, and this is overlaid, and then we have even more clusters. At some point you no longer recognize something. Yeah, so here you have the leaf node. The data set that is shown here is the fatal accident data set. That is a data set that relates to 230,000 car incidents, and several information is collected for each of these car accidents, namely how many vehicles are involved, just one, and a pedestrian, for example, or two or even more. How many persons are involved, whether or not the driver was drunken, and what was the speed limit at the place where the car accident took place. Yeah, so this is the four-dimensional data that is shown here. Yeah, visual separation according to clustering results can be supported with edge bundling. I mentioned this already, but want to integrate this catch here, which shows a little bit the difference between a conventional parallel coordinate plot without any edge bundling compared to the application of edge bundling. So in the top row, you see the conventional polygon type visualization, whereas here you see edge bundling. I would argue that in this example, the effect is particularly clear. Yeah. It is not that edge bundling can completely avoid that we have crossing lines. Yeah, we have crossing lines here as well, but their number is considerably smaller than here. And the same holds if you apply the top row here with the bottom row here, the number of crossing lines is reduced. And reducing the number of crossing lines helps to interpret an image because a high number of crossing lines really makes it difficult to follow visually where lines are actually going. Yeah, and that is the last remark that I want to make with respect to the visualization of clustering results with parallel coordinate plots, a comparison where, yeah, close to 4,000 elements or items are shown. On the left, without any modification, and on the right, color is used to distinguish two clusters, and also opacity optimization is used, leading to more transparent renderings of data sets that are far away from the cluster centers. So here a tendency is of course much clearer. Yeah. So parallel coordinate plots are really a quite useful technique with their enhancement and refinements to show cluster membership and how clusters are aligned. I would argue that it makes sense to still combine this with a scatterplot-based visualization, which would really show the borders, the spatial borders of a cluster. That is a kind of information you just do not have with parallel coordinate plots. Yeah, with this, I want to thank you for your attention. That was the first part here.